Welcome to our panel discussion on the U.S. Constitution. In honor of Constitution Day, which was this past Monday, this event is being sponsored by the History and Political Science Department here at Long Beach City College. My name is Gene Goss. I am Professor of Political Science, and I'm honored to serve as Chair of the History and Political Science Department here at the college. I will serve as moderator today. I will now briefly lay out our program and then introduce our panelists, and then we can get down to business. Again, if I could get quiet in the back, that would help a lot. Excuse me. After all panelists have been introduced, each in alphabetical order will make a 2 to 3 minute opening statement. When opening statements conclude, I will pose questions to the panelists in hopes of engendering some spirited and thoughtful discussion. Panelists will have to keep their responses to me and to each other to no more than a minute at a time so we can get a number of issues discussed today. At about 12:45, we will open the discussion up with the audience. Members of the audience will have an opportunity to pose a question or make a statement to the panel, and the panel, any and all the panelists, will then have an opportunity to respond to those questions or statements. It's my honor now to introduce our panelists. I'm going to switch to this different device here if I can figure out how to use it. I'm going to just point these people out, taking them in alphabetical order. Right here in the black shirt, to right one person over from the end, is Dr. Julian Delgadio. Dr. Delgadio is a professor of history at Long Beach City College, where he's taught since 1991. He holds an AA degree at LA Valley College, a BA and MA in history at Cal State Northridge, and a PhD in history from the University of California, Irvine. He's published many reviews in historical journals and has delivered papers at the conferences of the American Historical Association and the Pacific Coast branch of the Organization of American Historians. In 2005, he helped establish the Long Beach Community Studies Program at Long Beach City College. Dr. Delgadio is a member of the board of directors of the Long Beach Historical Society, and he's currently working on a book on the history of the city of Long Beach with his co-author, Dr. Craig Hendricks. The work is tentatively entitled Federal City. In September 1999, he delivered an address to the Long Beach City College Associated Student Body entitled, quote, "Has the Constitution Expired?" Close quotes. He suggests on Constitution Day 2012, we consider holding a funeral for the Constitution's unfortunate demise. Over to the left of him in the blue suit is Dr. Donald Douglas. Dr. Douglas is an associate professor in political science in the Department of Political Science here. He earned his doctorate at the University of California, Santa Barbara, and has been teaching at Long Beach City College since 2000. Professor Douglas is also a nationally noted political commentator whose essays have appeared at Front Page Magazine, PJ Media, and RealClearPolitics.com. Right here at the end of the table is Dr. David Lehman. Dr. Lehman has been teaching early and modern American history at Long Beach City College for 16 years. He earned his doctorate at UCLA, and his principal field of study in graduate school was in early American history, the period in which our Constitution was created. Down one room from the end is Dr. Sandra O'Toole. Dr. O'Toole received her Bachelor's of Art degree with a double major in political science and psychology from the University of Michigan, and then went on to receive her Juris Doctorate from the University of Notre Dame. She was a practicing civil litigator in Southern California for several years when she decided to go back to school and earn her Master's in Business Administration. Dr. O'Toole has enjoyed a professional commitment to support and serve legal aid programs and has conducted many seminars in various aspects of civil law to her peers. She has taught at Cal State Long Beach, Western School of Law, Southwestern, and the University of Southern California in the areas of business law, contracts, corporations, civil procedure, and legal writing. Since 1999, Dr. O'Toole has been teaching business law and international business law at Long Beach City College. And finally, lastly, but certainly not leastly, at the very end, is Dr. Laura Pellegrini. Dr. Pellegrini is an alumnus of Long Beach City College, right here. Yeah, we're very proud of that fact. And has been teaching here for 15 years. She holds several degrees from the University of Southern California, including a PhD with an emphasis in law and public policy, and I know she's done a lot of work in constitutional law, and an MA in political science, as well as a master's in public administration in intergovernmental management. In addition to her education, Dr. Pellegrini has worked in national, state, and local government. She prides herself on balancing her academic training with real-world practical experience. Now I would like each panelist to share their opening statements, and we'll start in alphabetical order with Professor Delgadio. Julian?
Can you hear me? No. Oh, how about now?
Oh. Is it on? Turn the mic on.
Yeah, it's on. How about now?
There you go.
So you got to get close to this thing.
You can take it off the hook.
That's true. Let's just do that. There we go. How's that? All right. Thank you for inviting me to be a participant in the panel on the Constitution. It is the 225th anniversary of that great document. But I'd like to begin by bringing up Ralph Waldo Emerson. Emerson is important to our culture because he was the guy who told us that we all deserve to have an original relationship with the universe. And what he meant by that was that we should be the creators of the world that we live in, not just inheritors of a past. So yes, it's 225 years of the Constitution, but we need to think critically about that document and what it has delivered to us as the fundamental law of the land. The other day, I was rolling through campus, and I happened to see a student carrying a textbook. And the title of that textbook, which was a political science textbook, was The Living Constitution. You know, I had to laugh. The Constitution is a system of fundamental rules and principles of a nation, a state, or body politic that determines the powers and duties of the government and guarantees certain rights to the people within that administrative unit. That's just a generic definition. In the broad sweep of history, law ensures peace and security to a society. Constitutions appear as an alternative to arbitrary power. We all know from our early American history, that's weird, that the Constitution was written and it arose from an experience that Americans had with the arbitrary rule of a monarch, the King of England, George III. The written Constitution was an innovation designed to control power and thereby preserve liberty and freedom for those in the system. This was seen as necessary. We all know James Madison's famous quotation, "If men were angels, we should not need government." But government was necessary to check an untrustworthy human nature of the masses, but also of the elites. This was Madison's great insight. A written constitution represented a detailed set of do's and don'ts for the political authorities to abide by, as well as an outline of the structure and function of government and office holding. In retrospect, the idea that the founding fathers could design a system of constitutional government was a massive generational conceit and an illusion. Madison understood the danger. If government was necessary to control men, who would control the government? The Founding Fathers' answer was a kind of political science that was new. It was called, they called it the method of counterpoise. That is to say, use a system of checks and balances within the government to try and keep the government in check. But unfortunately, that system of checks and balances has broken down so many times, we have to wonder about the method of counterpoise. It was apparent to thoughtful observers as early as the mid-19th century that the Constitution had failed to control power. After all, President Polk launched an undeclared war against Mexico and stampeded the Congress into a declaration of war after a two-hour debate. Not exactly the control of the president in that moment. Henry Adams.
Got about a minute left.
Okay, Henry Adams blew the whistle in his famous autobiography called The Education of Henry Adams, which I recommend to all of you as must reading for every college student. What Adams realized was that the Constitution couldn't control private power. That is to say, the rise of the rich, the rise of a plutocracy. In 1900, the first billion-dollar corporation appeared in America. In 1999, the first $500 billion corporation appeared in America. That was Microsoft. Constitutional government couldn't prevent vast concentrations of wealth and power in private hands, and it led to a new agenda for government, which was to try and control vast private wealth through an expanded government. Okay. But as we are witnessing in our lifetimes, that project has failed. Moreover, constitutional government has made many compromises with state power, and this especially around the issue of the president's taking us into wars, which began with Harry Truman, after all, who got us involved in the Korean War and didn't even ask Congress for an approval. It's only gotten worse. So what we've seen in our own times is the rise of a national security state along with a plutocracy that demands an accounting for, but we just don't get it. Now, on that happy thought, I'll stop.
Okay, Dr. Douglas, going in alphabetical order here.
Check, 1, 2.
It's on, right?
I think it's on, is that on?
Yep.
Yeah, okay.
You can hold it if you want.
All right, I've prepared brief comments. I hope I'm not overshadowed by my distinguished colleague, Professor Delgadio, but when I received the invitation to participate at today's panel from Professor Goss, one of the questions that he had posed to us as panelists was, is the Constitution an anachronism? And I thought to myself, who invented that question? Not Professor Goss. Someone somewhere down the line had this idea that the Constitution is an anachronism. And so I thought to myself, while I was getting ready to prepare the comments, no, the Constitution's not an anachronism. The Constitution is the law of the land. The Constitution is, to quote former Attorney General Edwin Meese, dedicated to the preservation of personal liberty, political freedom, economic opportunity, and the natural rights with which we are endowed by our Creator, unquote. So why do we celebrate it? Why are we all gathered here today, packed in, standing room only crowd, to discuss our Constitution? We must think it's quite a wonderful document, or at least worthy of our attention, whether or not we can preserve the liberty that it was designed to protect. And when I say that liberty, that blessed, bountiful freedom that, frankly, we take for granted. On Tuesday morning, when I stopped to get my coffee, I stop off at 7-Eleven, and they have all the papers arrayed out there, New York Times and stuff. I didn't buy the paper, sometimes I do, but I looked at the New York Times and had a picture, the front page, top picture at the top of the page, of a group of immigrants that had taken their oath of citizenship. They had their naturalization ceremony on September 17th, Monday, that day. Must have been an extremely important day for them. Not only that, doubly so, because they swore their allegiance to the Constitution on the 225th birthday of when that document was signed. I thought that was a fabulous thing. And so I asked myself, and sometimes I ask my students, why is it then that immigrants keep flooding our shores? They must have some sense that while the United States isn't perfect, we have a dreadful history of oppression and slavery and perhaps imperialism and genocide, depending on who you talk to, maybe ask a few Native Americans. Despite that history, much of it we've been trying to amend or atone for or overcome, people still come to our shores. At least a million a year, sometimes 1.5, 2 million people come here every year. Probably because they realize that while the United States is not perfect and our democracy is flawed, it's the least worst alternative. There isn't a better system out there so far designed. And we've had this Constitution for 225 years or so now, and it seems to be doing a job. It's not perfect, and I have some additional comment along those lines in a few minutes after I hear my other distinguished colleagues on the panel.
Okay, thank you. Now, Professor David Lehman.
Thanks, Gene. I'm happy to be here with you today. I think it's totally appropriate that it's the Department of History and Political Science that is sponsoring this event, because we are two fields that focus on the Constitution, although I think we focus on the Constitution from pretty different perspectives. And I'd like to just say a word or two about looking at the Constitution from a historical perspective. As Professor Goss said, my field is early American history. I studied at UCLA. I had a wonderful seminar that I remember with a constitutional specialist. And I really am convinced from those years of studying early American history that the idea of constitutionalism, the idea that you have a written constitution that sets the rules of what government can do, that really is one of the two great accomplishments of the Revolutionary era. And even though we're a relatively young nation, the very oldest continuously surviving written constitutions come from that era. Actually, the oldest constitution that's still in effect is not the U.S. Constitution, it's the Constitution of the state of Massachusetts, but it has remained essentially the same with a few amendments since 1781. And if you look at this time period, it's fascinating how this idea of constitutionalism developed over time. First, the idea that the Constitution needs to predate government. You can't have the government itself set the rules of what government can do. No, you need a special convention of the people. That's an innovation that comes from the Revolutionary era. The idea that it has to be written down. The idea that even after you've written it down, you got to send it back to the people and have it ratified. All of that was, it seems very common to us, but that was brand new at the time, and that really is a huge accomplishment. And I do think that this focus on constitution writing, the fact that you had people who were devoted to writing constitutions, even while they were fighting a war against Great Britain, that was far from being a sure thing. That shows how, that really shows the key concern of this whole era, and that is, how do you have a government that gets done what it needs to get done without being a threat to liberty? And they worked on that really, really hard, and they thought that they came up with a solution, and it's a solution that has lasted for a long time. Today, we celebrate, as Americans, I think we celebrate the answers that they came up to this issue. How do you have a government that gets done what it needs to get done and not threaten liberty? Well, you have, as Professor Delgadio talked about, you have a system of checks and balances, or you have a set of rules. These are things that government can't mess with. That's what the Bill of Rights really is all about. These are things, rights of the people that government can't touch, right? And I do think that especially in today's political climate, if you are a small government type, and especially, let's say, from kind of a Tea Party perspective, I have a feeling that you celebrate the U.S. Constitution for the limits that it places on government, or maybe you, to turn it around, maybe you lament the way that its original intent, in your view, has been maybe subverted in some ways over the past 200 years. I do think that it's interesting, though, that at the time that the U.S. Constitution was written, that's not the way people saw it at the time. That's not the way it was seen by most Americans. Instead, it's fascinating. At the time, this Constitution that we're celebrating was seen as creating a much more powerful government, a much more centralized government than the nation had ever had before, and frankly, a government that was simply, in their view, too far removed from the people. So you know there was a huge debate about this Constitution, and mostly came from folks that said, no, this is creating too much power. So I just raise that to suggest that when we talk about the Constitution, we're approaching it from a pretty different perspective than perhaps 200 years ago.
Thank you, Dave. Dr. Lehman, Professor O'Toole.
When Professor Goss asked me to be a panelist here, I thought I wanted to jump at the chance to share with you why each of us sitting here today should be celebrating what I believe is the best living document we have. The U.S. Constitution, when our framers drafted this document, if you take a look at it and analyze it article by article, it's fascinating. It starts with "we the people." So it's interesting because it's about us. We should all take an interest because this document applies to us. It was written by us and it was for us. So that's an exciting start. It should capture your interest. It should capture attention. And as the business lawyer in the group, I'm not a content expert on the U.S. Constitution, but everything it represents is something that we should appreciate, value, and truly take the time to celebrate. And we look at the way the Constitution was initially drafted. It has, you know, the question was posed by Professor Goss. We take a look at it. Do you believe that this Constitution is relevant or significant today? Absolutely, without doubt. And I'll tell you why. When the people, that's us, created a system that's organized by the people and for the people, it's pretty exciting to be a part of it, to live it. We've died for it, and we're going to continue to preserve it. Article 1 is the legislative branch. I bring this up because for many students in my class, we're discussing contracts. This is a good one. But I want them to get a perspective of how the systems function. The legislative branch is most close to, as far as the connection to the people, because we the people elect who's in Congress, and that makes the legislature. Then you have the executive branch. That's the national constituency. That is us as a nation electing who's the president, vice president, and the representative department secretaries. Then you have the judicial branch. The judicial branch is a very important branch. It's become more important in recent years, probably more powerful in recent years. But all three branches are for a particular purpose. The legislature, what do they do? They legislate. What does that mean? They enact laws. They make laws. What does the executive branch do? It enforces the laws. What does the judiciary branch do? It interprets the laws. There are restrictions on each branch, so not one branch has complete control. And ultimately, with that in mind, we the people who's elected to have these three organizations run the country represent us and our rights. But when the framers drafted the Constitution, they realized it was not a perfect document. Because even though we had a really good system set up to have the people have a structure where they are heard, we wanted certain personal rights to be protected. Those rights were then later modified and amended, and the first 10, I'm sure many of you are familiar with them, they're called the Bill of Rights. The great thing about the Constitution is it is self-correcting. As old as this document is, the framers drafted it so that indeed, if society needed to modify or change society or culture or thinking, which we all know is necessary, there was a system in place to do that. So we had the first Bill of Rights, which enabled me, sitting here in front of you today, Douglas was just talking about this, why are immigrants flocking to this country? Right now we have 27 amendments to the Constitution. I can proudly say I'm a first generation immigrant. I was not born in this country. As you can see, that means I'm a minority. You can see I'm female. But what you now know about me through a brief introduction, for those students that have me, I'm a lawyer, okay? Those identities that represent me, minority, immigrant, female, and now a lawyer, and now I'm a teacher of law, those opportunities could not be afforded to me if it wasn't that I got to be blessed enough to be part of this country and have the protections and those rights afforded to me by the Constitution. So you should really celebrate. Take a look around. Everyone looks different. That's a good thing. Embrace it and appreciate that we're all here today and we're allowed to voice our opinions, as different as they may be. You may not have to agree with me, but you have the right to think differently. Isn't that nice? Appreciate how wonderful this document is. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor O'Toole and Professor Pellegrini, please.
Dr. Professor Goss. I just want to spend a minute or two and address a few of these things and talk about the changing of the Constitution. Oftentimes you hear, you know, it's outdated, it's old, is it relevant? I'm actually sort of shocked in some context that we would even remotely consider that it is irrelevant. People come here for those liberties and freedoms, the opportunities, as Sandra was talking about, are here. This is the place you get them. And how do you get them? You get them because of the protections of that document. And while some people say, well, you know, let's throw the baby out with the bathwater and get rid of the whole document and start over, the framers were humble. They believed that the Constitution could last, and in doing so, might need to change. So when they wrote the Constitution, they put in that document an amendment process. We can amend it. We can change it. We can tweak it, if you will, according to today's standards, looking at who we are and how we've changed as a nation, looking at our economy and our people. So is it relevant? My answer is absolutely, unequivocally, yes. I believe it is the document that provides for the freedoms and all the values that they talked about early on under Locke, limited government and equality of opportunity. All of those things are protected by that simple piece of paper, if you will. And getting rid of it would mean unbelievable hardship. We tend to forget 225 years later what the framers and the revolutionaries went through to create this country. If you look at the 56 framers of the Constitution, or the 56 signers of the Declaration of Independence and the signers of the Constitution, we're talking about wealthy, educated people who laid everything they had, everything they owned on the line to create a new system, a new document. And my question becomes, if there's even the tiniest consideration of getting rid of the current Constitution in its format, are we prepared to pay that price again? Are we prepared for revolution? Are we prepared for the absolute complete risk of everything we have to come up with something once again brand new? Because this is what they did back then. They came up with something brand new and they laid everything on the line to do that. And you know, walking around with your coffee and your newspaper is something that may become a thing of the past if we choose to try to completely uproot our system. I think the amendment process and the ability of the court to interpret certain elements of the Constitution give us plenty of latitude for what we need to change with the times, as it were. And I agree with my colleagues about, you know, immigration and people still wanting to come to this country and what a great country it is. And we may not be perfect. A quote oft quoted in many sources, I most recently read it in a Pat Conroy book, was the idea that America is a good enough country to die for, even if she is wrong. And our Constitution puts us in a position of saying, yes, the freedoms that are offered, the strength of character of this nation is held in that document. With that, I'll pass it back.
Thank you, Professor Pellegrini. Now I'm going to, as moderator, begin asking a series of questions to the panelists. And I'd like to have them limit their responses to about a minute, more or less, so we can get a number of questions accomplished here today. And I'd like to reverse the alphabetical order, since you're having to do everything last. I think we'll start with you and then work down alphabetically. I think we've kind of dealt with one of the couple of the questions I came prepared to ask today in the opening statement. So I'm going to jump ahead to something involving the amendment process. A number of constitutional amendments have been proposed in recent decades, many of them with quite a bit of public support. Most of them have failed. I remember the balanced budget amendment in the 1990s. I think it came a vote or two short in the U.S. Senate from meeting the two-thirds requirement and going out to the states, but it failed as well. Is the Constitution too difficult to change with our current amendment process?
My response to that would be that it isn't. It needs to be difficult to change. We can't willy-nilly take the Constitution of the United States and add in and remove things from day to day. It was never meant to be that type of document. We found that out with the Constitution in the state of California, which has been amended more than 500 times and quite frankly is a mess. So if we stick to big issues, right? Equal rights, voting for all citizens, those types of things, and not get down to little tiny minutiae, we can ensure the history of this document.
Professor O'Toole?
I'm going to agree. The framers of the Constitution, whether it was deliberate or not, I'm very happy that it doesn't take a snap of the finger to make an amendment. It takes two-thirds vote of Congress and then three-fourths of the states to get an amendment to the Constitution. The reason being is it's not supposed to be easy. It's not supposed to be easy to change something that has lasted this long, that has given us the rights we have. As society progresses, guess what? There is change that's necessary. But together, to create a more perfect union and keep it at that level, it does take all of us, which is the voice of Congress and three-fourths states. That's a lot of agreement, but it can happen, and it will, if the voice of the people want it to be done. So I think it's a good system.
Professor Douglas, or pardon me, Professor Lehman. Going to go alphabetical or reverse.
I do think that this is a good question, and it does strike me that we haven't had many changes to the Constitution in a long time. And when I think back to the beginnings of the United States under the Constitution, I'm not sure that that was expected, that it would be so infrequent, because we had quite a few amendments very early on. But I do think you're right. We have a system in which the stars have to be totally aligned for a change to come about. And that does reflect this kind of gut fear about powerful government where we started from. But I think we would all admit on this panel that there are some times that has really hamstrung us in some really hard to do something that even the majority of American people might see as a valuable change. But it's just.
Professor Douglas.
I agree with Professor Lehman. Sometimes the Constitution creates such intense obstacles to political change that people complain frequently that we have perpetual gridlock. And you can't change the Constitution without super majorities. You need 2/3 of both chambers to vote for an amendment, and then you need 3/4 of the state legislatures to approve an amendment. And it's extremely difficult to do. The Constitution has been changed technically 17 times since 1791. We had the first 10 amendments with the Bill of Rights, but then very few amendments after that. And so I think about that, but I think about the theory, and I think that's what Sandra and Professor Pellegrini discussed, is that the founders were worried about majoritarian power, that they wanted to place limits on the ability of popular and passionate majorities to perhaps pass legislation or change the laws that would trample the rights of individuals. So if you look at it from that point of view, that yeah, sometimes we have a lot of gridlock. Perhaps gridlock's the price we pay for a conservative document, and I mean conservative in the sense that it's slow to change, or it has to be, as David said, has to be the stars aligned, has to be something big, something extremely important to the nation as a whole to get the will and to get the consensus to change it.
Professor Delgadio.
Okay. I completely agree with what other members of this panel have said. This document, although I would go farther and say, this document was designed to make it difficult to change. That was the point. And I completely agree with Dr. Douglas's point about the anti-democratic nature of the Constitution. The Founding Fathers were not believers in democracy. When they constructed the system of government that they built, they called it a republic, not a democracy. And that was intentional. And so then you think of all of the major flaws, the undemocratic features of this document, things like the Electoral College, or the idea of senators representing states as opposed to people, which gives us the absurdity of 40 million Californians represented by 2 senators, and 2 senators representing Wyoming, which has more cows than people. So how do we deal with this stuff? How do we get at trying to change these egregious violations of majoritarian principle? Well, the founders have tied our hands. And you know, if you look at the history of the amendments to the Constitution, you only get movement when there's dramatic political conflict going on in the Republic. When the Constitution was ratified, 10 amendments. Well, that was because so many Americans at that time, look at what the Founding Fathers said, and they said, wait a minute, there are no rights protected in this document. And of course, the founders weren't interested in that. Alexander Hamilton, read Federalist number 84, he says, you don't need a Bill of Rights in this document. The only thing they put in the Constitution to defend individual right was the right of habeas corpus, produce the body. If you're going to arrest someone. In other words, charge them with a crime. So I think we're really stuck in many ways. You know, the amendments to the Constitution that have dealt with some of the egregious anti-majoritarian features, like direct elections of senators, great, but we still have senators. Why? I don't understand it. So the founders created a ratification process and an amendment process that add to our difficulties rather than help us. And they did it intentionally.
Thank you. I think we'll go back to alphabetical order and you'll take the next question, Professor Delgadio. Most Americans are aware of the importance of the Constitution. It was just mentioned that if you are an immigrant and you are taking your oath as a new citizen, you're taking it to the Constitution. And sometimes I believe that maybe some of these immigrants who are accomplishing this know more about the Constitution than some of us. It's pretty obvious that many Americans are not intimately familiar with its text or its precepts. Should our K-12 educational system place more emphasis on teaching the Constitution?
Why not? I think the more we know about the system, the better off we are. It's our clinging to the illusions about this document that keep us hamstrung in this situation of stasis, which is exactly where the founders wanted us to be. So we need to know more about the Constitution, but we need to know the reality. We don't need the illusions. We've got to escape from all of the rhetoric that we've attached to this document and that we've attached to this country. We need to see the world plainly. So if our education can help us to do that, I'm all in favor of it.
Professor Douglas. Yeah, the question is, should our K-12 educational system place more emphasis on teaching specifically the Constitution? We have civics courses. I'm of the mind talking with students coming out of high school that there's not much detailed discussion of the Constitution itself.
Okay, I thought about that question when I was preparing my comments. A lot of young people, and I would put myself in that category when I was 18 years old and I wasn't worried about anything except having a good time and perhaps finding a new girlfriend at the time. So, you know, you want to have a good time. But I wasn't worried about the Constitution. I wasn't worried about these questions of gridlock and these undemocratic Senate or whatever. So I would argue, yeah, there needs to be more attention in the educational system to our basic charter, our Constitution, but don't stop there. Students have perhaps not read the Declaration of Independence when they come into college. They don't know the history. They don't know, frankly, our political culture and our values. But let me say one other thing about this. I mean, the Senate, perhaps, is an anachronistic institution, but it serves its purpose, which the Constitution's thought that this particular body would be the least directly influenced by the passions of what they thought was the mob. When you talk about how the Constitution, Professor Delgadio talks about the Constitution as undemocratic, the founders actually worried that our political system might be too democratic. If you define democracy in terms of popular majorities, you possibly could get a super powerful majority faction in James Madison's words, that can control all the institutions of power and suppress the rights of smaller groupings of people, which are what he called political minorities. So the Constitution is built up very systematically through relatively indirectly elected institutions like the Senate, but also the President, the Electoral College, which is an indirect institution designed to take effect, to preserve liberty through checking our more populist-based institutions like the House of Representatives. It's a difficult balance to strike, but contrast the United States to France. France has had 12 political regimes since 1789. They've just now had political stability since, I forgot, 1958 or so under the French Fifth Republic. We're still working on our first constitution, technically, if you don't count the Articles of Confederation. Something has worked over time to not only guarantee liberty for people, but adapt to abandon the undemocratic, racist, sexist institutions that were the norm in the 18th century. Can I have another minute?
No, I got it. Okay. 1 minute at a time. Your next comment, edit it. Professor Lehman, I have to say, unfortunately, Professors Lehman and Douglas are going to be leaving us around 1:04 class. So after this question, I think we're going to turn this over to the audience so at least they can field a couple of questions from you before they have to leave. Professor Lehman?
I do think that what we heard from Professor Delgadio and Professor Douglas kind of point to when you talk about the Constitution, there's some really complicated issues that are out there. And I think I worked with fifth grade teachers here in Long Beach Unified School District, and I do think that when you're teaching the Constitution in the K-12, especially in the elementary school level, the tendency is, okay, well, we'll talk about the Bill of Rights, about the rights that come from the Constitution. But if you talk about the Constitution, as Kent said and as Julian said, there are some complicated things. We are not told in high school about this kind of anti-democratic aspect of the Constitution. We're not told that Alexander Hamilton gave a speech in which he said, the people are turbulent and changing. They can seldom judge or determine right. So this was a document that was written by people who were concerned about too much popular influence in government. But the fascinating thing is that they created a document that in the end would provide for exactly that, for an ability for ordinary people to express their views. I really believe that.
Professor O'Toole.
I think I'm going to go back and direct the answer to the question that was asked, which is, do I believe that more attention should be given as far as instruction with the U.S. Constitution with, did you say, kindergarten through 12th grade? Absolutely. We can change that limit. You can start preschool till your last breath. To be educated in knowing your rights in the spirit of the law as a lawyer, there's always a good time to learn. It doesn't matter if you're one, it doesn't matter if you're 100 or anywhere in between. There are different methods and manners in which to give that instruction, but I can say this, as an educator in the law versus an actual practicing lawyer, how many students/clients in my career truly understand their rights? They don't. It seems strange to say that. It really isn't even about K through 12. The wonderful thing about the U.S. Constitution is it's our public being. It is what makes us Americans. It is what makes this country unique. And the opportunity to learn about it is there for all of us. So I really do believe the sooner we start, the better, because all we learn is more information about what we have the opportunity to do, whether we agree or we don't. So absolutely, I think that instruction should begin as soon as possible.
Professor Pellegrini.
I will keep my remarks short so we can move on. The answer to the question is yes. We definitely should spend more time on the Constitution. I agree with Dr. Douglas that we should talk about the Declaration of Independence, which in my classes, I always say how many have read it, and I'm lucky to get two or three students who've actually read the 1.5 page document before coming to class. So there's no question. I would also add to that government employees. I made a phone call recently to the city of Long Beach. I live in the city and was inquiring about something. And I was specifically told I needed to do X, Y, Z. And I questioned that. And the woman on the other end of the phone said, "We're the government. You have to do whatever we tell you." So I would add that all national, state, and local government employees at some point be required to take either a political science class or learn about the Constitution and the Declaration.
On that note, we are going to turn this over to audience questions and statements. And I believe we have a microphone set up over here. Is that correct? So those of you who would like to address the panel, please come over to this microphone. We'll take you one at a time. Keep your questions or statements very short and to the point, no speeches, and we'll let our panel field it as you do. Yes, sir.
Yes, I just had a question as far as, do you think Shay's Rebellion was the actual thing that made the Constitution possible as far as you know, what it is today compared to how it started off?
Okay.
I think that
good
was
question.
A tipping point. Absolutely. That was the thing that convinced a number of people that something had to be done. because the idea that an uprising like that could happen in what we believed was a republic was just a very scary thing. So, yeah. Well, just real briefly, you'll have to take History 10 if you want to.
That's when the citizens in Pennsylvania brought pitchforks, farmers, rebelling against the government, saying, you cannot foreclose our houses. And they had an uprising against the government. And the Articles of Confederation was the original document I was trying to refer to, where it changed to the Constitution because the checks and balances they put in place to stop the uprisings against the government, and the therefore the government wouldn't be as too powerful as well.
Okay, we're limiting this to one question. If you could take a seat, please.
The fear there was that the national government wasn't powerful enough to respond to this uprising. So.
I'd like to say something about that, too. Shays' Rebellion was a product of an austerity program because the state of Massachusetts had run up big debts in fighting the American Revolution, and it wanted to pay off those debts very quickly. So they raised taxes on farmers, and when the farmers couldn't pay their taxes, they took their property. So the Americans in Massachusetts took up guns and took the position that we had the right to defend our property against a government that is oppressive. And it was that act, that movement, that produced, I mean, scared the crap out of the elites of that time, who after all were the ones holding the debt. They wanted their money. And the result was this counter-revolution, which is the Constitution of the United States.
Who else would like to respond? Okay, next question, please.
My question is, if the Constitution is a Constitution, the law is written and stuff, why is it that when a person goes to trial, especially being a lawyer, that you assume that if you have a public defender or if you don't put $100,000 into your case, you're not going to win? And it's proven with cases that we see, you know, that unless you spend $100,000, you're not going to get the fair trial you deserve.
Thank you for your question.
That is a good question. But I want to clarify what you're trying to ask. I know what you're asking is a perception of what you feel. Know this. It's pretty incredible that the Bill of Rights has introduced to all of us as American citizens, you're not, you know, you've heard the phrase, you're innocent till you're proven guilty. We have a right to a trial by jury. We also have a right to due process. We also have a right to, if you are in a criminal, you're a defendant in a criminal case, you do have a right to legal representation. There's, you know, if you look at the media, you look at the news, many people feel, if I can't afford a good attorney, if I don't have the dream team, the cash for that multi-million dollar loaded attorney, smoke and mirrors, I'm not going to get what I want. I'm not going to be able to, you know, I'm stuck. I'm serving time. Here's the deal. You have an opportunity in this country to have your representation paid for you by the people of the state. And I, speaking from personal experience, I had an opportunity to work in the public defender's office as well as the district attorney's office. And I'll tell you something, we work hard. We fight for our clients. It doesn't matter that the check is consistent and it's not increased because someone can't pay me more. I'm doing the job because I want to make sure that you get your rights protected. That is why we take the oath. So to devalue someone who has taken the oath to protect your rights, to say, well, I really don't have the money for a better attorney, that's a slap in the face. This is from someone who lived it. I've been in the side of a criminal arena as an attorney and in a civil as a civil attorney. You can make what you want of it, but many people that step up to the plate could make a lot of money in criminal defense if they're on their own. But many people choose to uphold the right that we are granted by way of the Bill of Rights through the Constitution to protect defendants. Okay. So know that we're doing what we can because we love this country.
Okay.
Anyone else want to field that question? Professor Pellegrini.
I would also say that while the Constitution guarantees you all the things that Dr. O'Toole was talking about, and all those rights are absolute, we also, as the populace of this nation, have a choice to participate. Too many times people will sit back and say, my lawyer, my congressman, my this person didn't do for me what they should have done. And my question always is, well, what did you do? Right? Did you participate in your criminal defense? Did you go to the library and look up whatever information you want? The library's there. You can pull the book off the shelf absolutely free of charge. It's not going to cost anybody a penny. Okay? Did you write your congressman? Did you write your city council member? Did you go to the board of trustees meeting here and make a statement about your education? And so while, you know, we can talk about the Constitution and the rights that it provides us, it also gives us that freedom of choice. And if we're not taking our opportunities there to participate, then certainly we need to question our role in the outcome of whatever the situation is.
Okay, next question, and I forgot my instructions from media services. After you've given your question, I have to restate it so the cameras can pick it up.
So my question is the Constitution itself vulnerable to outside pressure? For example, not the political side, but people who fund the political side, are they being pressured into forcing amendments or not passing amendments due to their own gain?
The question is the Constitution itself at risk from being approached by outside interests, or I think commercial interests or something of that nature? Anyone want to address that question?
I take the question to be a question of undue interest group influence on the political process and therefore on our constitutional liberties. It's a controversial thing. It depends on how you look at it. A few years ago, and I forgot exactly, but the Supreme Court ruled that corporations have a First Amendment right to contribute funding to the political process, campaign contributions. This has been very controversial. It's been divisive for a lot of people. A lot of people on the left argue that corporations don't have a First Amendment right in the sense of an individual in terms of free speech. But the Supreme Court has ruled that they have, corporations have that right. Therefore, do corporations and big business have too much power, too much influence? The response to that is that speech is best counteracted with more speech. Corporations don't always win. They're extremely powerful, but often the little guy wins or the little person wins by being able to participate and mobilize a coalition of interests to be able to combat that kind of speech. And if you see what's happening right now, the people who are calling, frankly, not just to end corporate speech, but also to perhaps pass either laws or perhaps amend the Constitution to prohibit unpopular opinions are people on the left, like Nancy Pelosi, even President Obama, would like to limit your speech. So I'm the kind of person that say, no, don't limit speech. People should have more speech. The antidote to unpopular speech or too powerful speech is more speech, not less.
Anyone else want to address this question? Professor Pellegrini.
My question would be, is outside influence a problem? Because it would depend on how you're going to define that outside influence. If you're going to define an outside influence on the Constitution or the constitutional process as including interest groups, then you're basically saying that people should not be able to participate. because you all join interest groups. You join the Sierra Club and you join your professional organization, and you join them for what purpose? To have influence over the political process. Most of us don't have the time to do it ourselves. We don't have the time to go door to door or to go to each individual congressional office to make a stand on what we think. So we join interest groups. If you work for a corporation, if you are a stockholder in a corporation, all of those entities do have pressure in the political process because they're all representing ultimately the people. And so to say that there aren't any, I think would be incorrect. And to say that there shouldn't be, I believe, is also incorrect. Again, it's a choice. We all make choices, what we join, what we participate in, but anything that ultimately represents the people should be considered in the process.
Mr. Delgado.
I think that's an excellent question. And, you know, Madison dealt with this question in the Federalist Papers, and I urge you all to read the Federalist Papers because it's one of the three critical documents for understanding early American history, along with the Declaration and the Constitution. But in the Federalist Papers, what Madison says is, look, you can't get rid of interest groups, these outside forces. I mean, that's, you'd be obliterating liberty and freedom if you tried to do that. So what did the founders do? They came up with this system of checks and balances, the idea being that by fracturing authority between two houses of Congress and between a legislature and an executive, and then a judiciary, that somehow that would prevent abuse by those different interest groups. And Madison was very upfront about his understanding of interest groups. He said, there are large ones that represent the rich, and there are small ones. And that will be the principal conflict in your society. Santa sounds like a Marxist, doesn't he? The problem is that private wealth has become so concentrated in this country that basically, what do you get? You get the best government that money can buy. And that's where we're stuck. So the founders have failed us with their design. The wealthy have simply purchased every branch of our government.
Next question, please.
Everyone seems pretty adamant about the way the Constitution is now, but what if in the near future everybody decided, like, there was enough votes about it being changed? How do you think that will affect the overall structure of America?
Let me kind of restate that. If in the future there's a wholesale movement for change among the population, what impact would that have on the system? Is that correct? Who wants to field that? Professor O'Toole?
Sure. That's a very broad area because it depends on what that change is. But if you're pertaining to, is there a possibility that we can change? Is that where you're asking? Or in particular, what type of change?
Like, people took the pursuit of happiness too literal, and they felt like maybe we should broaden that up or make it more specific. So it doesn't become a problem. So how do you think that would change, like, people's overall perception of America, and how do you think that would change the structure?
Well, that's an interesting question. Well, first of all, know this, the purpose document that when you're talking about the pursuit of happiness, the Declaration of Independence clearly says we have unalienable rights, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The wonderful thing about those rights, it's depends, your perception may be different for what constitutes pursuit of happiness versus mine. And the reason I believe the founders framed this structure and this language is because we are very different. Everyone's different. Everyone has a different interpretation of the pursuit of happiness. But in response to your question, if there's enough that want change, the system is set in place as it stands to have a modification. Again, it's difficult to make that happen, but it's meant to be difficult because you want to make sure that a structure and a document that has lasted, where many governments look around, there's not a lot of kings anymore, okay? But we still have a president, and it's still run with separation of powers, checks and balances, for the people, by the people. We have a national election. If the people do want change, there are structures to make those amendments happen. But again, I think when you're in referencing, it's important to say the pursuit of happiness. The document's written so that my pursuit, I can go ahead and achieve my dream, which may not be the same dream as you. But we have the ability and opportunity to achieve your dream and my dream, the way it's written. So again, if you're dealing with modifications as far as a movement towards something more specific, I think obviously it's drafted that it could happen, but it's written to incorporate everyone's individual pursuit.
Professor Douglas.
I think, let me tie in a little bit of this discussion we've been having, especially about young people and participation. And you referred to what's going to happen in the future, and not just questions of pursuit of happiness, but again, back to our fundamental debate here, the question of liberty. Young people need to take ownership of their system. Every generation comes along, there comes a time in the life of that generation that they will become the nation's leaders. Sometimes I doubt that young people today are being educated or being empowered with the skills that they need to sustain liberty. I'm less worried about powerful corporations as Professor Delgadio is. I'm worried about powerful government. And how do the people protect the government? Let me just give you two examples, then I'm going to have to excuse myself to go to class. One is the Obamacare legislation that was passed in 2010, and the Supreme Court just recently upheld it. And the ruling was controversial on whether or not government can compel individuals to buy a product in the marketplace. And the Supreme Court said, well, you know, it can because it has the power to tax people, and the mandate was a tax. But there will be more challenges to Obamacare going forward. One of the biggest challenges, one of the most controversial challenges, is the requirement that insurance companies pay for contraceptive health. And that include things like birth control and access to abortion services. Private insurance providers are not exempt. The Obama administration does not exempt the Catholic Church and its institutions, hospitals and insurance programs that are affiliated with the church. They see this as a violation of the First Amendment. The President of the United States was sworn in to uphold and protect the Constitution, and he's not. He's not on that issue. He does not seem to care about the concerns of people who are Catholic and whether or not they will be forced to pay for abortions in their health care programs. A second concern is the President himself. The President himself has taken it upon himself, I'm talking about President Obama, has taken it upon himself to decide which American citizen will live or die. In 2011, on September 11th, the President of the United States, Barack Obama, made the decision himself to execute an American citizen, Anwar al-Awlaki. Anwar al-Awlaki is the radical imam who had he had mosque and he had teachings in the United States, and then he fled the country after September 11th and moved to Yemen. And in 2011, the United States launched Predator drone missiles and took out his vehicle and killed Anwar al-Awlaki. Anwar al-Awlaki was an American citizen. Anwar al-Awlaki was not a participant in September 11th. Why is the United States government taking it upon itself and the administration deciding that it can assassinate what we expect to be political opponents or religious extremists? And I want to quote, the Justice Department and the Office of Legal Counsel in the White House has said that while the Fifth Amendment guarantee of due process applied to the case of Anwar al-Awlaki, it could be satisfied by internal deliberations inside the executive branch. So in other words, due process is decided not by individuals and not by the courts, but the White House. So I think, back to the question about participation, do you want the United States to survive as a democracy of the people? Or are we going to allow more and more power of government, not just Barack Obama, but Dick Cheney and President Bush, and any future president that decides that we can invade any country that we want and that we can execute any American that we want because we see them as a threat to national security? That's the big problem. And I'd like to see what Professor Delgadio would like to say to that.
Care to comment?
Well, I wanted to comment on the question, which addressed the issue of what could we produce if we could just change this document, this archaic thing that we're trapped with. And you know, this idea of the pursuit of happiness, if you think about it, it's a description of motivation. You know, it's attributing to Americans this idea that they're all going to define happiness in whatever way. But you know, if you go back to the founding fathers, who, after all, weren't Thomas Jefferson. Jefferson wasn't at the Constitutional Convention. He was the author of the Declaration, where you get this idea that pursuit of happiness is what a fundamental right of Americans. In the writings of someone like Alexander Hamilton, who we revere so highly, you know, he doesn't have a very flattering view of Americans. He actually says in one of the Federalist Papers that Americans are ambitious, vindictive, and rapacious. Now, you want to apply those terms to yourself? Do you see yourself in those terms? Is that who you are? Or maybe you have a different view of yourself. Maybe you have a more positive and optimistic view of yourself. And that based on those elements of human nature, perhaps we could do something to produce a better system of fundamental laws in this country. We could get rid of the Electoral College. We could get rid of the Senate. What a waste of time that is. We could have a unicameral legislature with majority rule, and then maybe we could empower Congress to actually do things for us. Can you imagine that, a government that actually does things for us like they do in other countries? How about a 5-week vacation once a year? How's that sound to you? So I think that there's a tremendous possibility there, but we have to have faith in ourselves, and we have to free ourselves from the assumptions that the founders have left us with about who we are, because we're not those people. I don't think of myself as that kind of a person. Thank you.
Next question, please.
So do you think the Constitution needs to be changed, or perhaps more people just need to be educated on the Constitution? And what about our politicians who seem to circumvent, you know, the document?
Which one do you want? There's three different questions there. Which is your, the one you want to focus on?
Well, in general, does it need to be changed?
Okay. The question is, does the Constitution need to be changed? And I'm taking right now, right?
And yeah. Secondly, is there a better solution? Absolutely, even just be educating the people.
Okay, well, let's go with the needs to be changed one first, okay? Good, that's a good question. Okay, just go down the line.
First of all, the question is somewhat vague. Does it need to be changed? How? When we change the Constitution, we have to change it to do something very specific. So to say, does it need to be changed, is like saying, would we like it to rain tomorrow, in the sense of how? So in asking this question, I would say, does it need to be changed to do something? What would you like it to be doing that it isn't doing? How would you like it to be changed? Versus, are you just trying to throw the whole thing out and start over? That's not change, that's constitutional convention, okay? More education always helps people to understand. If more people had more education, maybe more people would want to change it. So you don't know what the connection between those two things is going to be. So. That would be my, I mean, I know you're not supposed to have another question, but did you have something specific in mind?
No, I mean, it seems to work perfectly, though.
Okay. So you like it the way it is?
Yes.
Okay.
If it's worked for 200 years, why change it?
Okay. So that's really your question. Why change it? Yeah. Okay. Okay. And I think that would be for Dr. Delgadio. Because he's the one that seems to be more in favor of change. But
I'm not persuaded that it's worked perfectly for 200 and something years. In fact, if it had worked so perfectly, why was there a civil war? You know, which was an utter breakdown of this system. What was it? Something like 78 years after its conception. So, and this, it has been amended on numerous occasions. I think it should be amended additionally by doing things like, hey, how about a positive right to vote, a national right to vote in the Constitution? We learned in 2000 in Gore v. Bush that, it's hard to say that man's name, but we learned in that decision that Americans do not have in their Constitution a right to vote. I mean, there are rights to vote in state constitutions, but there's nothing in the federal government. They left that to the states. But you know what? I think we all deserve the right to vote. What do you think? Yeah, yeah. I'm sure there are not everybody would agree with me on that. But there are reasons for that. So that's one thing. You know, I recommend that you read a really interesting book. It's not very big, less than 200 pages. And it's by a political scientist named Robert Dahl. And it's, the title of it is, How Democratic is the American Constitution? It's a great book, and it takes us into all these issues, and we get to see the evolution of the Constitution and all of its flaws. We have to free ourselves from the rhetoric that says, it's the greatest document that was ever produced, and we're so blessed to have it. I'm sorry. It's not. It was produced by human beings who had certain interests, and they designed it to protect those interests. And we're human beings, and we have interests, and we should design it to protect our interests. That's all I'm saying.
If, okay. if we get I another, oh, you're gonna respond, okay, I'm sorry.
I need to follow that, because I am proud to say I think it is the greatest document. I'm gonna tell you why, Professor. Because you have the right, and it's fabulous to hear your right, why you believe, you know, this is an antiquated document. You would not have that ability to voice that right without the present document as it is read. That's why this is so important. It gives people that want the document to change, modify, claim it's antiquated, whatever negative comments you want to make about it, the document allows you to make those claims. That is something that you should appreciate. Without it, before this Constitution was drafted, if you talked about, I don't like the government, guess what? You're locked up. You can say whatever you want about the government. Oh, that's right. Forget hiring me, because you're not going to get one. And it's not certainly paid by the state. So remember that. It's fabulous to be able to criticize, but know that the right to criticize and voice your opinion and disagree, we have the right to disagree. We can agree to disagree. But those rights are contained within the document that has lasted for over 200 years.
Can I get another question? We need other kids.
Can I just comment? I would like to agree with O'Toole specifically because I'm first generation born here, plus to change it would be change it to somebody else's self-interest as well, so.
Thanks, Alvaro. Next question, please.
My question is, does the Constitution still provide for us in situations of uncertainty of our nation state? And a particular example for that would be the Patriot Act, and how it, you know, the whole violation with privacy, and, you know, because essentially the government is supposed to protect us in all circumstances, but in that particular case, or maybe you can relate it to another case, does it still provide us in situations of uncertainty?
Let me see if I can restate that question. A law was passed a number of years ago after 9/11 called the Patriot Act, which enabled our intelligence agencies, both domestic and international, to collect information and merge that information and enable them to do more to track people suspected of being involved in terrorism. And your concern is that that might have been unconstitutional.
Yes, like.
And so you want us to address that question.
Constitution okay. Still protect those individuals when circumstances arrive.
Okay, good question. Let's start down, Dr. Pellegrini. Yeah.
I'm contemplating for a moment. Does the Constitution still protect us? Well, again, it's a document, and there's the theory versus the reality, which is always something that sometimes we can't rectify in our system. You know, the Patriot Act was put into place at a specific time for a specific purpose. The majority of the members who voted in favor never read it. So they didn't even know what they were voting for. I'm not sure we could find one American who's ever read the entirety of the act or could explain it to anybody, which certainly makes it difficult to say what's in it or what they could use it for or against Americans. But generally, your question of does the Constitution still protect us, my answer would be yes. Because ultimately, if you feel that the Patriot Act, man-made law, so to speak, you can challenge it. You can challenge that law against the Constitution and say, what you're trying to do, government, with this law is unconstitutional. And there is a form of redress for that. So is it swift? No. Are you going to get the result you necessarily individually want? Maybe not. But ultimately, I believe that the Constitution still does protect our rights and our freedoms. And, you know, Congress and government, and they get carried away and emotional and all that. And so occasionally laws get passed that we would question, but there is a process. So vaguely, yes.
To follow up with that, the answer would be yes as well. But to understand it in a little bit more simplistic terms, because many of you are saying, Patriot, what is it? Many of you do have some idea. You can opine, academics theorize, for and against. Is this invasion of our privacy? Is it not? Too much government interference? The bottom line is, we were faced with something we've never been faced with before. The presidential powers were expanded to respond to terrorism, okay? Is it the best system? It's not perfect, it's not the best, but it's the best we have for defense. If you don't like it, there is systems that we can channel to make change. But the number one thing that people have to remember is the Constitution made from the people, by the people, it's there to what? Protect the people. So sometimes laws have to be made in response to a changing culture, a changing environment. We didn't have all the different forces against us that we're dealing with today. As a result, the Constitution, as old as it is, within the barriers and structures that have been looked upon and examined, allowed us to have some sort of response to the terrorism that was created. Again, many people feel that that response definitely infringed on your personal rights. What's nice is you have the ability to voice your opinion and try to get something repealed. So there is a process. So, yes.
Anyone else want to tackle this?
Yeah, I'd like to respond. But I'd have to say that I don't believe that the rights of Americans are being protected. I think they're being violated every day. And this is not new. You know, someone said earlier that the First Amendment is an absolute right. I got news for you. The First Amendment hasn't been an absolute right since 1919. When the Supreme Court ruled that your freedom of speech could be limited under certain circumstances. In that case, war. You know, and there's always been a tension between liberty and security. That's, you know, that's going to happen, and that's going to be played out over time. But since 1919, the First Amendment is an absolute. There are circumstances under which you cannot speak out. I'm sorry, Supreme Court. Now, for the really bad news, every day, people, the National Security Administration collects 1.6 trillion emails, phone calls, text messages. Anytime you pick up an electronic device, they're getting that, and they're storing all that information in warehouses in Utah. And they can do data mining to see what you're saying. Oh, you know, pick out some words. Are you using the word bomb? Or maybe you're using the word critic or some other word that they're interested in finding out who's using that. So I urge you never to say, I think she's the bomb or I think he's the bomb, okay? Just don't use those words in your vocabulary. Every day, 1.6 trillion messages collected by the government.
Next question, please.
I just want to say thank you guys for speaking today. I wanted to go and clarify that the forefathers wanted to make this country a republic and not a true democracy. because of what's going on in the Middle East, where it's a mob rule, and if the mob gives up and rises against and destroy and can bring down the whole society. And I'd like you guys just to reflect on that.
The question is that the framers of the Constitution originally intended a republic, not a majoritarian democracy. I think we've touched on that already somewhat. And in comparison with what's going on with the revolutions in the Middle East, where you're having majoritarianism outright, you want us to kind of compare that and discuss that, correct? Any takers?
Well, American history has lots of incidents of mob rule. So we didn't escape that form of behavior. Other countries are going through it now. I don't think we should think of us as so much, you know, superior to them, because they're having those experiences, because we had them.
Any other comments?
I just wanted to touch base on this. In order to prevent a revolution, the framers drafted the Constitution with the system and organizational fashion of checks and balances to prevent the revolution. That's what it's there for. It's added the Bill of Rights. Those are our rights. They're special. They're unique. The system that has been set up is there to preserve those rights to us as Americans. It's set in place to prevent that type of revolutionary conduct, which would then be a market different system.
Next question, please. We'll be wrapping this up in about 2 minutes.
My question is the way the Constitution sets up the structure of government too skewed in favor of the two-party system, whether or not that was intentional?
The question, very interesting one, is the system, what is now set up, our political system, which is essentially a two-party political system, is that a threat to the Constitution itself? Is the Constitution at risk because of that? Please.
My question was more, does the Constitution make it like inevitable that there is a two-party system?
Does the Constitution make it inevitable that there's a two-party system?
Not explicitly, but okay. Does it?
No. I would say the Constitution doesn't specifically say there has to be two parties. In fact, the state of California has more than a dozen political parties, just because the majority of people choose to be one of the major parties, because those are the parties that tend to have more power, doesn't exclude additional parties, as I mentioned, with interest groups. Political parties are interest groups. People can choose a different path if they wish. A two-party political system has sort of bubbled up, if you will, in our system, because it actually lends greater stability in government. The more parties you have, the more unstable the system of government becomes, because of additional parties and sort of the struggle or split over power amongst four or five entities instead of two. So I don't think that the Constitution specifically created or exacerbates the two-party system. And the two-party system, again, like everything else, it certainly has its flaws, and that would take another hour speech. Certainly has some benefits as well. One of those, greater stability for our system.
Bakers.
I'll respond too. I just want to say that the Founding Fathers didn't like political parties. And the system they designed wasn't supposed to have political parties. In fact, their idea was that by strengthening the central government, you could expand the United States. And in this expansion, you know, as you add more states, you would multiply interests. And you'd make it more and more difficult for those interests to coalesce into a party, or, you know, one party or two parties or however many parties. And this was all part of that fracturing of power that they sought. But of course, this is another example of where they were totally wrong. You know, they thought that the country would be run by people like them, you know, educated, wealthy elites with leisure time. But they very quickly lost control of it. And political parties developed to replace them. And it's just another instance of where the work of the Founding Fathers leaves them in the dustbin of history.
Any other comments? Well, that takes us to 1:30, folks, and that concludes our program. Please join me and give a hand to our panelists. The college has taped this, and this proceeding will be on YouTube at some point in the future. So if you know somebody that might like to see it, tell them about it, and I'm sure you can find the link off the homepage at the college. Thanks to all of you for spending time with us today. Have a great afternoon.
Stop picking on the only thing we have left.
I know.
Come on.